Building your first cube is no small task. It can often take days or even weeks of planning, and can be incredibly overwhelming your first go around, especially without any kind of guidance. So today I want to go over how I first started building my cube, and some general best practices in my opinion. So first things first, what is a cube? A cube is a pre-built pool of cards that you put together to create your own limited draft environment. You and your friends shuffle up and randomly pull cards from the cube to create what are essentially packs to draft with. While cubes are often considered just to be the best cards from Magic's history, and oftentimes that is the case with vintage cubes for example, it is very important to focus on the draft synergies and archetypes rather than the sheer power level of individual cards. The ultimate goal of building and playing with your own cube should be to create the most fun, limited environment for you and your friends, which fortunately means rarely are you going to run across two cubes that are identical. So the first step in building a cube is going to be figuring out what kind of cube you actually want to build. Simple enough, right? There's really no right or wrong answer for a first cube. The first iteration of my cube, for example, was somewhere between a modern and a legacy power level. And as time went on, I decided to add power and basically transform it into more of a vintage cube. And that initial power level choice was really stressful to me for a little bit, because when you're getting started, things can feel very locked in to what you decide. However, what you build now doesn't have to be the final product. And in reality, your cube should always be changing and evolving, so don't feel like you're making the wrong decision because there isn't one. And you can always change your mind later on like I did. That being said, for your first cube, design what you love. If you just really enjoy high power level and busted gameplay, make a powered vintage cube. Maybe modern or legacy as your preferred eternal format, build around one of those. Maybe you even want to try to build around an EDH cube where you have a separate draft pool of commanders and then you build decks around those later on. Maybe you want to play entirely with uncards. There's really no right or wrong. You can build cubes around sets or blocks. You can start with no format in mind even and just use the cards you already have in your collection. And I think that's how most people really start out. The only thing I would personally advise against is a standard cube, because keeping up with rotation in that way would be really expensive and honestly just kind of obnoxious in my opinion. That being said, if that's what you want, more power to you. A lot of people recommend either a pauper or peasant cube for your first one, which is a cube comprised of either all commons or all commons and uncommons. And while this is a great way to get into building your first cube, and it's going to be way easier on your wallet than, say, jumping into legacy or vintage, it's by no means your only option for building something fun without breaking the bank. One thing that for whatever reason does seem to be a little polarizing amongst the cube community is going to be proxy cards. What is a proxy? A proxy can be any number of things, but it's ultimately a term used to mean anything other than an official Magic card to represent a Magic card. So my preferred method of printing proxies are printing out the actual card with art and everything on regular printer paper, and just setting that inside the sleeve over a basic land or just a random card turned backwards. Proxying has been really important to me with trying new cards in my cube before actually spending the money on them. Especially when you're building a cube with older or reserve list cards, the paper vintage cube experience should not exclusively be for people who can drop $50,000 on cardboard. I would just try to proxy in as clear a way as possible. Writing a card name alone with no other info on the back of a card, for example, could be plenty for you to understand what it is. But to all the other drafters, it could get really confusing if at least the rules text isn't present. And a lot of people, myself included, actually recognize the card art before names, so try to be mindful of that and provide as easy of an experience to your players as possible. When I first started my cube, it was actually about 80 to 90% proxies at first. I didn't have thousands of dollars to invest in the cards that I wanted to play, but I did have enough for a set of sleeves, a cardboard box, and a friend of a friend who happened to work at Staples. And over time, I just gradually bought the cards as I was able to. Building a cube really doesn't have to be a huge initial financial burden, and if it doesn't bother you, you don't actually have to buy those cards just to enjoy games with your friends. Although supporting your local game store is never a bad idea, especially if that's where you do most of your cube drafts. So now that we've decided on a type of cube to build, the next step is determining how big we want our cube to actually be. So this is going to be dictated by what kind of archetypes you want to include, and how many players you anticipate regularly drafting with. Generally, cubes are going to be between 360 and 720 cards, with 540 being kind of like the standard size for most cubes. So with 360 cards, you'll be opening every single card in your draft with 8 people, And with 720, you can actually have two pods of 8 or one giant pod of 16, which I don't really recommend. It gets a little chaotic. So for example, if you regularly draft with less than 8 people, a cube with around 360 cards can make combo archetypes like Storm or Splinter Twin a little more viable to draft, and be more certain those cards will actually be opened. On the flip side though, with fewer cards in a cube, the drafts do become a little more redundant over time, opening the same things over and over. I generally draft with 4-6 people, and I've been really happy with my cube floating around 450 to 500 cards. I find there's a good balance there of diverse deck building and also having enough support for like combo archetypes. And even in 2-person grid or Solomon drafts, I've been able to build a functional Storm deck in my cube, no problem. With that being said, building a smaller cube your first go around is definitely going to be easier and a little less overwhelming, and you can always make additions to up the card count over time. So now we hopefully know roughly what kind of cube we want to put together, and we have a decent idea of how large it should be. So now it's time to start planning. What kind of archetypes do you want to include? Do you want each individual color to have its own role when drafting, or do you want to focus instead on archetypes in 2 or even 3 color pairings? Ultimately, that's up to you. Starting out, giving each color its own identity is great, but fleshing out 2-color pairings is where most cubes want to be, in my opinion. Blue-white being control-focused, black-red being aggressive, black-green caring about the graveyard, and so on. It's your cube, and you can make these whatever you enjoy playing, and you can even make a monocolored cube if you choose so, with only blue cards if you hate your friends. As individualistic of an experience building a cube is, I'd also strongly recommend looking at other cubes for inspiration while building your own. Most of the Magic Online cubes are a decent jumping off point for building a Legacy, Modern, or even Vintage cube, and there's so many great Pauper and Peasant lists online as well, just to use for a reference of putting yours together to compare. Generally, cube is thought of as a singleton format, meaning that traditionally you only include one of each card in your cube. However, you don't necessarily have to adhere to this, especially if you're trying to simulate a set or a block draft, or if you just think having duplicates would be more fun. Another way that cube differs from booster drafting is rarity. In most standard boosters, you're only getting one rare per pack, where the rest is just commons and uncommons. When putting a cube together, unless you are building a Pauper or Peasant cube, rarity is completely meaningless. So when we're putting our cube together, we do want to adhere to a few ground rules. So in cube, your basic lands are going to be separated entirely and not drafted with the rest of your cube. Non-basic lands, however, are an integral part of playing multicolored decks. As such, we want to make sure we have our cycles balanced. So when choosing lands, try to have duals in every color pair in even amounts. That doesn't necessarily mean having the same exact complete cycles for every color pair. So for example, if black-red is your aggressive color pairing, a fast land is perfect, whereas if blue and white both have a lot of cards with high devotion in either, a filter land makes a little more sense in that specific situation to me. However, starting out, it may be easier to just focus on full symmetrical land cycles. So you have your dual lands, your shocks, your fetches, maybe creature lands. It's just easier starting out, but you definitely have flexibility there. In my cube of around 480 cards, I've got 5 lands of each color pair, and I find that to work pretty well. Although you may want to play around with those numbers. For example, a 360 card cube could likely get by with just 4 of each. In a 720 card cube, I'd personally prefer close to 7 of each 2-color pairing, or maybe even do 6 of each 2-color pairing and the triomes. However you split it up, just make sure it's consistent throughout the color so your drafters are able to actually build the decks they want and aren't forced into the decks that you have support for. Similarly, you ideally want to have the amount of cards in each color be more or less balanced. It's hard for a green deck to come together if you have 80 of both blue and red cards and only 20 green cards in your cube. While usually it's best to adhere to uniformity here, the ratios don't have to be perfect, and if you're a few cards over or under for a color or two, it's likely not going to be noticeable. Similarly, you can actually skew these ratios intentionally. For example, in my cube and many other vintage cubes, blue is widely considered to be the best color to draft. And because of that, I've got about 10 more blue cards in my cube than the other colors, just to make it easier for multiple players to draft blue if they choose to, without being cut in the draft. And again, looking at ratios for other cubes online can be a great way to get an idea for what you should be shooting for, and sites like Cube Cobra are great places to do so. So two common templates for building your first cube, assuming we're going to start out with a 360 card cube, are going to be something like 60 of each color, 30 non-basic lands, and 30 colorless cards. Alternatively, you could do 50 of each single color, 30 non-basics, 30 artifacts, and include 50 multicolored cards this time. Generally, I like running fewer numbers of multicolored cards in my cube, as this makes playing two colors or even monocolored decks more viable, and in general has more flexibility when drafting. Split devotion cards are another great way to get around this, being cards that can be cast with either color of mana in their identity. Another important thing to take into account is going to be your mana curve in each color. You want to make sure you have a curve that suits your strategies within each color and color pairing to make drafting a playable deck easier. For example, say green wants to be the ramp into large creatures deck. Yes, you want to have several options for high CMC creatures to actually ramp into, but that's going to be really hard to do if you only have three one-drop mana elves in your cube. And if red is supposed to be the aggressive deck, you want to focus on having more early, fast creatures and burn spells, rather than focusing the bulk of your red cards on Glorybringers and Inferno Titans. These cards are great to have in your cube, just not in excess if that's not the focus of the archetype. So when I was first making a list, I had a spiral notebook with a page or two organized for each color combination, CMC, and so on, and that worked really well. However, like I mentioned earlier, sites like Cube Cobra, Cube Tutor definitely make the process a lot easier, more streamlined and organized. So I would definitely recommend utilizing those tools. Choosing which cards to include in your cube once we've established a rough idea of archetypes is probably the most important part of building a cube, and is almost certainly going to change often as time goes on. Every few months, I usually examine the cards in my cube and make replacements with newer cards from recent sets. Probably the single most important thing that I like to try to include a lot of is cards that fill multiple roles. For example, Deviling Season can go into a token strategy or a deck that cares about +1/+1 counters. Frantic Search is great in Storm, Reanimator, or even just like a standard Spells Matter deck. That way you're filling multiple roles with a single card, and you're freeing up more room for additional cards as well as offering an easier drafting experience for your players. One thing to keep in mind when making these choices is the signals that certain cards might give. For example, if you're going to include a card like Oath of Druids or Channel in your cube, you'd better have some Eldrazi and other large creatures as a payoff for playing that card. Otherwise, the drafter is going to view that as a signpost for a strategy that doesn't actually exist in your cube, and that's not fun for anybody. So making cuts and upgrading your cube is arguably the actual hardest part of owning and maintaining a cube. While not cutting and just growing your cube exponentially as new sets are released is certainly an option, it's generally not going to be very sustainable to maintain archetypes and so on, so we're going to have to make cuts somewhere. The easiest cuts are going to be cards that are strictly better versions of cards you already have. So, for example, Hero's Downfall recently became Murderous Rider in my cube. While the removal side is technically speaking not strictly better, as it does cost 2 life, the upside of having a lifelink creature that you can cast later more than makes up for it. A more straightforward example would be cutting Shock for Lightning Bolt, as Lightning Bolt is more efficient, it does 1 more damage for the exact same mana cost. Although more often than not, you're not going to have strictly better versions. You're going to have to do some evaluation. So like Knight of Autumn, maybe a replacement for Reclamation Sage in some cubes. But the 2-color requirement might not offset that versatility in other cubes, making Rexage a better option. It really just kind of depends. Another thing to look out for when you're making cuts in your cube are going to be cards that are consistently picked 13th, 14th, last. Especially cards that don't really fit into a lot of archetypes, that's usually going to be an indicator that something is not going to be missed. Another thing I do want to touch on when you are comparing your cube with others online, you may notice that archetypes and card choices may vary slightly with similar style cubes. And while a lot of people try to build the very best, most efficient cubes possible, remember to prioritize fun. If you and your friends don't really enjoy fast combo wins, but you love janky flicker synergies or an obscure draft archetype from Khan's block, include those mechanics. Remember, the first priority of cube is always to have fun. One thing you and your drafters will likely notice on your first iteration of building your cube is that one or two strategies are overwhelmingly better than the others, leading to less diverse and just kind of boring matches over time. After all, why draft a new mechanic when Jeskai Planeswalkers is unbeatable in your cube when it's open? For this reason, you may need to nerf certain archetypes by removing problematic or just unfun cards, or alternatively up the power level of archetypes that are kind of underperforming, just to promote a more balanced, diverse playing experience. Playtesting regularly with friends early on and ascertaining the power level of all of your archetypes is a vital part of creating the ideal play experience. For example, Narset Parter Veils is a great card, and really it's not inherently too powerful for my cube given the amount of broken archetypes in it already. However, it just isn't very fun to play against, so I decided to cut that just for the greater health of the cube environment. Similarly, as you're building or upgrading your cube, be sure to talk to and get input from people who regularly draft your cube and see what cards and archetypes they enjoy and which ones could be improved or replaced outright. After all, the goal of cube is to have the most fun limited environment for everyone. So definitely be sure to listen to and take into consideration what your friends and other drafters think. So once we've either purchased all of the cards we plan on using for our cube or have a ton of paper proxies, what else do we need before we sit down to actually draft? So aside from the cards themselves and enough basic lands to support a draft, we're going to need some sleeves. It's very important to make sure you're using the same sleeves for your basic lands that you have your cube in. And there's an overwhelming amount of options out there for sleeves, and I'm really not the product review guy. However, for my cube, over the last few years, I've used Dragon Shield outer sleeves and KMC Perfect Heart inner sleeves, which I would highly recommend investing in, especially if your cube has a lot of foils. Even if your cube doesn't, some kind of inner sleeves are going to, in my opinion at least, provide a necessary layer of protection. On top of that, if you want to make life a little bit easier for your friends, having the appropriate tokens that the cards in your cube create can make keeping track of board states a lot easier than just using dice or coins. On a similar note, it's a good idea to have a few dice and counters just to keep track of planeswalker loyalty, plus one counters on creature, and even just determining who goes first in matches. The last thing I would view as a necessity to have for your cube is something to store everything in, both for ease of transport and protection. If you're on a budget, you can almost certainly get a long cardboard BCW box from your local game store for just a few bucks. However, again, there are a ton of nicer options for cube storage, and I'd highly recommend something a little more secure if you do have a particularly expensive cube. I've been using the Dex Protection Supreme Game Chest for a few years now, and I honestly can't even find anything to complain about with it. So really, this has kind of been a broad attempt to cram as much info into as short a video as possible about building your first cube. And while I really hope this serves as some kind of jumping off point for someone first getting into cube, I'd be more than happy to answer any in-depth questions in the comments and even potentially expand on this with a more in-depth video on the actual cube building process in the future. Ultimately, building a cube is a lot of work and it requires a lot of time and thought to go into a good cube construction. However, cube is, in my opinion, the ultimate limited experience, and I think most people would agree with that, and it's the absolute most fun way to play the game. So if you made it to the end of this video, please consider subscribing, leaving a like or comment, telling me what kind of content you'd like to see in the future. It really helps the channel out a lot. As always, thank you so much for watching.